Salam alaikum. Deputy Speaker, shukran jazilan. I am very thankful with the Republic of Egypt for this very kind invitation. Having the opportunity to speak about interfaith, intercultural dialogue for a parliamentarian, it's a precious opportunity because that's precisely the nature of our responsibility. Parliamentarians represent the people. Yes, our Deputy Speaker was mentioning the Charter of the United Nations that starts, "We, the people of the United Nations." And yes, we do represent that people. At the UN, we have the governments seated, reaching agreements, exchanging point of views. But when it comes to parliaments, there we see the plurality of the people that we represent. It is within a parliament where we see the different religions, different genders. We see different nationalities sometimes, different ethnical groups. It is in a parliament where we are seeing different political parties, different leaderships. There is the plurality of the majority and the opposition. And it is precisely in the parliament where we need to find the values that we have been talking about all this day. It is the nature of a parliament to find understanding, to understand that empathy cannot be underestimated. It is in a parliament where we need to understand that dialogue, tolerance, and respect are our most important values to understand each other and to find the best for the society that we represent. The parliaments have their important responsibilities. One of them are legislation and budget allocation. Yes, we decide the rules for the society. How are we going to behave with each other? How are we going to live with each other? But we also decide the budget, which are basically the priorities for our country. If we are saying that we have a priority, but that is not reflected in the budget, that is certainly not a priority. That's a political narrative, that's campaigning. But those are two of the most important responsibilities that we have as parliamentarians. And I think that here we have also a lot to say, because when we are discussing and then deciding budgets, we are also deciding the present and the future of the societies that we want to build. And yes, we have a lot of lessons from this pandemic, lessons that are painful, lessons that are going to be very complicated for all humankind. But one of the most important lessons is that we need to choose how are we going to allocate budget. Are we going to continue allocating budget, for example, for war and security? Or are we going to take seriously the development agenda, the SDGs, and to allocate the money for education, for health, for opportunities? When we are talking about terrorism, I'm from Latin America. We don't have the debate about terrorism, but we do have a real problem in terms of poverty and inequality, just like Africa. We have a problem with violent criminals. We have drug cartels. And that what means is that we need to create opportunities for youth. And that's what we all have in common. If we want to ask the new generations for understanding and tolerance and peace, then we need to give them the opportunity that they deserve. And that goes precisely to the parliament, to make more inclusive legislation. And that goes also for women and girls. Now that we're always talking about the 21st century and about being inclusive, 2.5 billion women and girls are being discriminated from the very basic legislation of their countries. We don't have equal legislation. We don't have equal budgets. Allow me to give you a couple of data. When it comes to the composition of parliaments and comparing to the composition of the world, well, women are more than half of the total world's population, but we only have 25% of the seats of our parliament. But when it comes to give opportunities to youth, because we're always talking about youth and how are we empowering young people, well, let me go to the data. People under 30 years old represent more than half of the total world population again. But when it comes to the seats in the parliament, they only have 2.2% of the seats. That is not democratic. That is not inclusive. That is not the way to teach the new generations about understanding, empathy, dialogue, and peace. So we need to understand that we need to strengthen our institutions. We need to strengthen our democracies, and clearly we need to strengthen our parliaments. Now, I am not the president of the Interparliamentary Union anymore. Now I am co-chairing the steering committee of the UHC 2013 movement, which is a universal health coverage movement. And allow me to use this very important example, because I do believe that this is precisely the kind of conversations that we need to start having. We were talking about how United Nations, how this international sphere is related to the local solutions, to real changes for the people that we represent. And when it comes to promote health for all, it is because if we do not change our path, by the year 2030, 5 billion people are not going to have access to health. That's the size of the challenge that we have. And that is why we need to understand that we need all hands, all minds, all hearts. We need everyone working in the same direction. And that's why we cannot afford to continue fighting, because we have differences. Yes, we can pray to different gods, but at the end, we are brothers and sisters. We are the same humankind, and we need to find solutions for all. The COVID-19 is not discriminating religions. It's not discriminating nationalities or passports. It's not discriminating cultures. And the same is happening with climate change or with the economic recovery. We need to work together, and that's why I think that understanding is going to be key for a new recovery, for building back better, just as the United Nations Secretary General has said many, many times. We need to translate international agreements into national realities. And here I would like to underline the importance of political will. Yes, political will, it's about parliament, but it's also about a commitment for all of us. We need determination. We need to take a decision on which is the generation that we would like to be. Are we going to be the generation that brings solutions for all humanity, or are we going to continue with the fights that has been destroying humanity for centuries and centuries? The pandemic has exacerbated and polarized our societies. It has undermined public trust and our community ties. It has also ended family meetings and mostly all of the in-person reunions for a year. The pandemic has changed a lot of things, and we need to understand and to learn the lessons from this pandemic. I do believe that we can build back better. I believe that we need, yes, this interfaith, interreligious, intercultural dialogues between the because the challenges are common for all of us. And then we need also common solutions. We need to work together. We need to see ourselves as the brothers and sisters that all our religions are saying. If we take a look to Islam, to Christianity, to Judaism, We are always talking about love. We are talking that we are brothers and sisters and the same community, and we pray together to the same gods. Yes, it might be different between one to other religion, but at the end, faith can move mountains. And that is precisely what we need for humanity today. We need to understand that the responsibility of a parliament can be that force to move the mountains if we are working together. I am sure that we can be the generation that ends climate change. I am sure that we can be the generation that ends all discrimination. I am sure that we can be the generation that ends terrorism. I am sure that we can be the generation that writes a new page for humankind. Thank you so much for this lovely invitation and the opportunity to see the best part of all humankind, which is our faith and heart. Thank you so much.